Welcome everybody, and thanks for inviting me to do a presentation around Extrahop. First question I have to you all is that is Extrahop familiar to you? No? Okay, good. Then I presented, the right deck, and Robert, myself, and Edwin decided to give you a little bit idea about what Extrahop can bring in terms of visibility into specifically software-defined networks. And the topic I want to cover today is why there is a need, from an architectural point of view, why there is a need for an ITOA architecture in SDN environments. We all, Arista and among all other players, are talking about SDN from an automation, software-defined, orchestrated point of view. Yeah? So it gives you a lot of positive things from delivering services. But one of the main concerns, not only in SDN world, but in, let's say, next generation architectures, is that what is going on in your network, right? So what applications are running over the wire? What, who are they talking to? So how can I get visibility around it, and how can I gain control? And that's the topic of today. That's the topic. My name is Rolf, and I'm working at Extrahop as a system engineer covering the Benelux area. So, by addressing the need for ITOA architecture in software-defined networks, let me start first by the current situation we are facing today. So, everybody, look at this slide. Do you see recognition over here? If you take a look at the fact, how do we monitor today our current environment? Sounds a little bit familiar? You have a networking tool for performance on the network side. You have a database tool or a database profiler, which gives you insight on the database part. So you have it on the storage, so you have it on different other elements. The point here is, there is no correlation between them. If a user has a problem accessing an application, is that caused by the web tier, or is that caused by my database tier, or is my storage just working not fine? Nobody can tell you that, because all these things, in Dutch, spaghetti. All those monitoring tools have one element in common, and that's it's tool driven. It's only looking at a tool solving a specific thing. And this is a funny thing I wanted to put in there, right? So this is the result of having all those tools. So somebody from the storage team is saying, it's the snake, yeah? And another one is saying, who is responsible for the virtualization team, it's the wall. Everybody say, it's this, it's that, but nobody comes to the conclusion. What is really causing headaches from an application performance point of view, or from a visibility point of view? Well, this is just the first slide, I put it together. So having said that, tool-driven monitoring is not the right way to do it. And especially if you take a look at what is happening today in the industry. It's not only about software-defined networking. It's also about creating web microservices, containerization. You have a community about DevOps. Applications are being spun up and teared down in the same day, maybe within an hour. So, what? Yeah. Yeah, no, you're right, yeah. And then in the DevOps community is doing tests against, let's say, a test environment versus what are they going to do in the production. How is a test application running in production, and how can you make that visible, etc. Other things happening, virtualization, not only on the server side, but also on the networking side. And this is all causing, if you want to, let's say, summarize it in three things, is that this is causing a lot of complexity. Scale is increasingly, because we all want to go for more and more centralized service offering in all in the world. And a very important thing is that we call that from extra of dynamism. You can also put the name agility in there, right? So things change frequently and fast. So why the could you cope up with your situations and keep control of what is going on in your environment? While your environment is designed for a rigid architecture, bullet blocks, you have rigid tiers, three classical, three tier architecture from a networking point of view. Then you have the classical tiers from the application teams, the database teams, the networking teams. They don't work together. Yeah? And now we are, through the megatrends happening, we are in a total different, we are stepping into a total different world, which means we want to break down the silos from a networking system application point of view, but that also counts for insight in what is going on in your network. So are you able to control having application insight while we are more on the right side and your monitoring architecture is designed for the left side? I think the answer will be clear. Yeah, definitely not. So what do we need to do to change that? To change that, don't think of Extrahop, and I think as the industry, that we need to create one super duper extraordinary product, right? We need to take it from a different angle. SDN, dynamism, agility, organization, etc. Why is that so powerful? It's so powerful because all defenders and integrators and everybody involved, they take an architectural approach. They don't stick onto a product only. And that's exactly what I meant by this, I mean by this slide. So from an operational management point of view, I'm saying we need to step up, move away from tools, look at what is common, and that will be data, so that will come later. But take the architectural approach. Put it in four sources. Call one wire data, the left one. The left one, yeah. Wire data, then you have machine data, you have agent data, and you have synthetic data. Wire data, what does that mean? Wire data is the transactions going over your infrastructure. It's not necessarily wired. Could also be wireless, but we call it wire data. Wire data is the only one who serves global states. That's really a difference. Global state means if a VM is brought up in your data center, whether it is in my application tier, database tier, storage tier, whatever, somewhere in my network, we will spot it because there is a new transaction brought up. That's what we mean by global state. And we look at, we observe data, we look at the transaction. Where machine data, typically examples of machine data would be NetFlow, for example. You have NetFlow running on your router switches, and you are exporting some interesting data to centralized systems. That's machine data. SNMP is an example of that. and Microsoft, WMI, all examples of machine data. And why are those machines able to deliver that information? Because they run some kind of intelligence on the machine. A router without NetFlow support will not, never send off NetFlow information. That's the whole point. So that's local state. Local state in a centralized model. Agent data, typically companies who look at application logic, Dynatrace, App Dynamics, just to name some. They look into .NET applications, they look in Java applications, and they can really do some clever things over there. But again, it will only be visible at the systems they are put on. And I'm not talking about the effects, the downsides of putting an agent on a system, because there are inherent issues, right? It's the same as do an SNMP network on a router and put that system down. And the last thing is probe data. Probe data, also called synthetic data. Synthetic data means that from a system I do tests. I run test queries to predict how that application performs, based on my test methodology and things like that. All four have a place within the whole architecture. But as why data is global state, it's a distributed architecture, I will come back to that later. It's the most important source, and I will come back later that we are not only saying that, but the industry is saying that right now. And the point is, we are, if we take this approach, we take the approach from tool-driven to data-driven. This is, I did not have another software-defined network architecture, but everybody recognizes this as an NSX architecture. And, the recognition is there that it's a software-defined network. The point I want to make with the fact is that all the things happening in that type of networks, changes, etc., the complexity and the scale, we see everything transacts on the wire. So although the applications there is a lot of complexity involved, by looking at data which is going over the wire, we can simply unveil the complexity. This is the point I wanted to make. So the industry and nowadays Gartner has brought out an update on their research note. They basically say if you want to look at from IT operational architecture, that why data is the most critical source. To get insight in availability and performance management. And why is this so important? So availability nowadays is not anymore something around I sent a ping or I sent a packet and I got a packet back. So request sent in, response coming back. Every e-commerce site, every cloud service provider delivering services and other companies, they are being measured on application performance. So take yourself as an individual. If you go to a website and you type in some URI and it takes ages or multiple seconds, you go off. You go to another site, right? It's not that that site responds to you. No, it's the speed of response coming back. And that really means that business is done or not. So availability, the next definition of availability is application performance, application processing time. And via wire data, we are uniquely positioned, wire data as technology is uniquely positioned to get insight into that, even in the most complex environments. So, talking about wire data, having said, and why they it is in essence it is real-time streaming and doing the analysis of the raw packets which comes into our platform, from which we are able to extract different type of information. So, by using wire data in real time, you can spot on, identify, do I have a security breach going on? Nowadays, ransomware, very hot topic going on. We are in real time able to identify that. It's just a specific extension, file extension, which you need to monitor. We look, by the way, header and full payload. We identify them and flag that real time. We can do that. We are not a security platform, but we can flag that. And here comes the thing. Another institute, not the smallest one in security area, NSA, did some months ago, some guy from NSA did a presentation about what is the biggest fear of NSA towards the IT industry. And it came down to the fact that that guy was explaining why NSA was so good in what they do today.
Ask Snowden.
What?
Ask Snowden how good they are.
Yeah. So, why are they good? They have focus, they have money, they have people, they are deterministic in trying to achieve their goals. And the one most important thing, what this guy was saying, is that we know the topology of the customer better than the customer. Basically, he's saying the customer doesn't know anything about this.
The regulator on their side.
Yeah. The fifth point, right? So, they know the topology better than the customers. And while they know the topology better than the customers, they are able to maneuver within the infrastructure, not being spotted, and take some infiltration, etc. What are we doing? By observing wire data, is that type of behavior. So what this guy implicitly said was, the industry having those kind of solutions, wire data, real-time streaming analysis of wire data functionality, those guys are our biggest fear, because they spot what we do. And we cannot hide anymore. So, that being said, that's something which we can deliver in this security area. So we can say, how is your application performing? But, where is it? Oh, here. There is also an interesting thing about business relations, right? So by looking at everything which is going over the wire, we are able to identify, for example, for credit card companies, from which area, from which region are transactions being made to work, via which credit cards, what is the amount of transaction, and put a transaction in amount of dollars, you can say, this is the best revenue income from this region versus that region. This is just an example of having knowledge and extracting data from header and payload. That's one. Another use case is around healthcare. Healthcare is using specific protocols like HL7. HL7, healthcare layer 7 protocol, is being used when you go to a doctor. If you go to a doctor, you're ill, you got some medicine, or an aspirin, doctor puts it in a system and runs through the system, blah, 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 and then finally it ends up at your house. That whole process, we can put that into the picture. For you, maybe not so important, but you can think of the ideas that we can see when, let's say, a flu is going, is exploding at which region, because doctors and nurses and other type of people are ordering specific medicines. So there is other information which we can extract from that, apart from the regular stuff. And that's basically what Extrahop as a platform is doing. And listen very carefully, I talk about a platform, not about a product. Going back to the ITOA architecture, which starts with the four sources, there are other things within an architecture which are mandatory. And what are those things? Is that you have something which is either on the left upside, extensible. Yeah? We have a bunch of information which is very valuable to, let's say, to people who collect HMA, syslog servers, order management servers, etc., etc. We can expose that information to them. We call that technology open data stream. So you can expose our data by HTTP, syslog, Kafka, MongoDB. Those are the functionalities we support. And so we can integrate, for example, Splunk with us, right? And as you know, Splunk is very good in log analysis, but it costs you enormous amount of money if you collect all logs, right? Put us in front and tell to us in real time, I want to be informed about information within the logs which hits those parameters and send them off. Instead of the administrator looking into 100,000 logs per day, he only has to look into, put it 1,000. Yeah? So that's something we can do. But we can also integrate towards security systems, FireEye, firewalls, in order to create real-time security networks. Because we see the wire on the wire what is going on. If we inform those systems over our RESTful API with what is going on, they can take action on their security policy, automated or manual or what have you. So that's the left side. The other thing important is, and that's what we are here for around, is orchestration and automation. Yeah? I want to do as much as possible with the less effort I have. So I want to use scripts or the type of automation tools, etc. We have that. And so we can either be, let's say, present or grab data over the RESTful API. We have an API Explorer integrated. We can do that via Python, curl, even PowerShell. And this is an interesting thing. I don't know if that's in the slide here. So it's not in here, but I will tell you the story around it. So why do we have PowerShell integration? That's because we are going to integrate from VROPS, VMware operational, virtual real-life operational system, directly into VROPS workflows. So you can imagine that when you are going to instantiate an application with VMs, CPU, storage, etc., from the workflow, you get the option, XROP, check in box, and the other option is, where do I want to have information from? Ordinarily enabled from this source to that destination. Check, check, check. Go through the workflow, automated, deployed, etc., and working. This is important, right? If you want to be part of an architecture. The other thing is that we have one of the fastest search queries, the big data search platforms. Where literally you can look for, for example, in all the transactions going over the wire, I'm looking for a specific file name, or I'm specifically looking for a specific user. I type in the search bar, type that name, type that file name, and it will be presented which flows per flow, which flow has a hit on that. And from that flow, I can do a further analysis, depending on all the metrics we collect, we can say, this was a database query which was causing this error, and it had a lousy performance time, and I can translate that to a web request from this user. All stitched together. And the other thing is programmability. So we have out of the box, are there 45 protocols now? Today we have 45 layer 7 protocols supported out of the box. Layer 7 protocols means framework, not port, right? We know the framework. If HTTP changes from port 80, 88 to 9000 or what have you, we know the framework, we identify that as HTTP. The same we do for all the database stuff, etc. So, am I doing right on time? Yeah? Okay. and that's out of the box. But you can configure yourself additional protocols. We call that Universal Protocol Analysis Module. So you can add protocols to yourself. As long as you know how the framework works, put it in via triggers, JavaScript, put it in and enjoy. Fully supported from a platform point of view. So this, what I wanted to articulate is that we are not only part of an ITOA approach, we are really putting, let's say, value as a platform into that architecture. And that's really the difference between having a platform versus a tool. How does it work? Quite easy. Easy slide, isn't it? No, so how does it work? So from the left side, this is your infrastructure. We get a span tab into a component what is called EDA, Extrahop Networks Appliance. On that one, real-time stream assembly is done of the packets. The assembly means that packets comes in, we play it around our own TCP state machine and pass it up to 3500 metrics today. And those metrics could be HTTP processing time, could be layer 2 bytes, HTTP, could be HTTP errors, could be database errors, could be TCP zero windows, retransmission timeouts, what have you. We all reconstruct that. So from layer 7 all the way up to layer 7, from layer 2 all the way up to layer 7, we have a full picture of what's going on. So we can segment, is your problem on the network, the real network? Is your problem in the application? Which tier, app tier, database tier, storage tier? What is the end-to-end view? What have you? Yes. So those unstructured packets are assembled and they go into what we call structured packets. And you end up to here. We can deliver dashboards for typically the three main areas, DevOps and IT operations, security and business operations. And this, so the heavy work when that's done over here, we can send that information off to a component which is our search appliance. By the way, as a management interface, you interface to this box, and you will get the results, right? You should not go to two boxes. But this is big data, detailed transactional data. As long as you have enough storage capabilities, you can collect all your transactions and being able to track down for maybe forensic analysis and that type of thing, everything what is going on. And there are in the title some very important things mentioned here, and I think I touched here. So remember how to discover, observe, and analyze. When you're in a very dynamic environment, one of the things you want to do is to make it easy to deploy. So So put our box in a network, fire span, get the data in there, and then we do for you auto classification, auto deployment, and we auto map, let's say, servers to groups. If we see servers acting, responding on shift requests, so meaning sending shift response, we flag that automatically as a shift server. For database client sending database request, it will be seen as a database client. And we group them all together nicely, automatically, all the way bottom down. You immediately see which servers are behaving as database client or web server, and maybe also as a database client. That's all done real time and automatically for any type of network. Could be the traditional network with or without VLANs, the modern networks, VXLAN, GRE, even fabric path. And today or this week, 5.2 has been released. That's our latest release. In that release, we not only decapsulate VXLAN, so looking at application information from VXLAN, but we can also tell you how VXLAN has behaved. So we collect metrics around VXLAN. And why is that important? Move a little bit to here. Measurement of SDN control plane. So, has anybody asked himself when he was doing, let's say, exercises with SDN solutions, whatever that solution might be, you configure the things on your SDN controller, and then let's hope that all the requests ends up to your destination and everything is being configured, right? Does that sound familiar? And I'm not saying that is not happening, most of the times it happens, but you don't know what is happening. We spot that type of traffic in addition to, let's say, your data traffic as well. So we can give you a confident answer on how did your RabbitMQ, how did you OpenFlow, how did you XMPP type of protocol, how did they behave in your environment? And an additional question to this is that you can do an estimation of your scale, right? Some solutions can send out 10k messages per second. Other solutions, 100k, 1 million, etc. What is your limit? Are you trusting the data sheet, or is that really what you're measuring? That's the difference here. We do that. We can do that as well. And let me coming back to microsegments, which is very hot today, getting all those web microsegments in your network. You want to know what is happening in this microsegment. So customer A is launching in microsegment B. What applications are in there? How do they connect to each other? How do they connect to the outside world, etc.? You want to get that insight as fast and easy as possible. Because of the fact, we look and segment the networking portion into VLANs, microsegments, etc., and can get the application metrics per VLAN per network. We can show you right away. Track VMs. So you have a situation that you want to make a change, right? So imagine you're a customer. You're not on a software-defined network, you're on a traditional network, you want to make the migration to SDN. So, for a vendor who wants to sell this solution, they have to convince the customer, but assume now that the customer is convinced. And you want to see as a customer, did that really bring me or brought me the value? How is it performing before, after, and that type of thing? As we do real-time, let's say, observation, and have the possibility to look back, depending on your storage capability, etc. It's roughly around 1 month, 30 days. in the worst case, we can see what has happened. And those are valid cases. I have dealt with a customer last week who did the migration from application code X to code Y. They could, by looking at the KPIs defined, the dashboards defined, they could see the performance was getting better. And even though it was not optimal, but it was getting better. That's easily addressable. So you can also track changes from, let's say, pure private to hybrid or public, that type of thing. And validate your security policies, right? So security policies are mostly tied to VLAN zones, etc. More and more customers want to let's say, to tie them the zones and to strengthen the security around it. But what happens when somebody implements a security policy with the idea that they believe that, okay, those guys were talking to those servers and not to those servers, and now I apply a security policy around it, where those guys cannot connect to their servers anymore because I did not have insight in how my applications were flowing through the network. That's what we address over here. So, very important functionalities within a software-defined network environment to touch on. What a discovery, it must be being able to deploy physical, virtual, in cloud, what have you, and looking at all transactions and not a part. Yeah. This is global state. I can do some interactive stuff. I will leave it up to you if you want me to go to some screenshots of dashboard examples or what have you. What did you say? Then I need wireless. Is that a problem, Edwin, to get wireless? I'm mixing up. I can do it without wireless. I will stay behind my laptop and you have to look at the screen. But what you have here is the UI of Extrahop, of the EDA. And basically you have three main areas here in the top: dashboards, metrics, and alerts. I will show you things within dashboard and metrics area. So let's go to the metrics area. So I was saying something about the auto classification. So what I just did was click on the metrics side, and then you're within the activity group. Here you see, based on the traffic we have seen, and by the way, this is a static packet capture which runs on my machine. It does not come out of the blue here. It's not Sugar Phillips network. So from the activity groups, we auto classify everything what we have seen into what you see over here. So by clicking on, for example, SIF server, you go into a detailed view, and on the left side, if I click on devices, I see my devices, which acts as a SIF server, right? So that means those systems react on SIF request out of the name of the client, so to speak. So that's the outer grouping. And if I click onto devices in here, so for this where are we? So this is the period I'm looking at. So this is the last 50 minutes. So I discover all those devices, which are 471 devices. To show you that it's really changing, and although it's a static one, if I select last 6 hours, you will see that value change, right? What is it? 516. So since last 6 hours, I've seen those devices. If I want to take a look at one of the devices, click on that. And then I'm on the device level. And here you see the total breakdown from layer 2 to layer 7. What did this device has seen? So if I go into layer 7 protocol, I see, okay, it has seen over the last 6 hours, it has seen Citrix icon, and this was the client who was connecting to this device through icon. If I let's take CDP server. Why is this? So I was in the HTTP server group, so that means that it responded on an HTTP it responded on a request. But and due to the name, I also know that it is doing some database stuff, right? So again, you see the full breakdown here. So for HTTP type of things, for database type of things, and it was flagged automatically. If I go to the layer 7 protocol, I see a bunch of SIFs, but if I click on this one, which is DNS, I see that it's also serving DNS in this period of time from this server. So this device, so the devices automatically in your database. And the other thing is that, so let's go back to SIF server, go to devices, and let's take this device, right? I have an option here, which is called activity map. And now it's asking, okay, from this device, output format PDF and all the network traffic, I can either select it or deselect it. Say, okay, go ahead. What would be rendered right now is that from this device, all the communication we have seen, and it's visible from the left side, and now we'll plot that into an activity map. Hopefully that. And here I see, this is the server. It has three. It had three devices, as we already spotted. This one, SharePoint, SharePoint, something, and then Microsoft connecting to Hyper-V, and the thickness of this will show you how much bandwidth there was. From this activity map, I can immediately, by clicking on this one, I go to the device. So I can automatically generate an activity map who is talking to what type of applications, etc. But this is one of the things I wanted to show you from the outer discovery, the outer classification part. You can do some very clever things within devices. Here, you have some options. One of the options is put a tag in there. So, for example, if you want to measure the performance from, let's assume the situation, you're migrating from VMware hypervisors to IDV. You can tag your devices with, let's say, either VMware tag and the other device with a Microsoft tag, and see then, based on the statistics, how they behave from an application point of view. Those are some options you can do here. Another interesting thing I wanted to show you is that so I'm now back on the dashboard side. If I go, So, what do you have here? By the way, I extended my screen by the little thing over there. This is an application we created called Apex e-commerce, which is a typical three-tier classical application, independent of on what network platform you run. You see on the top HTTP, database here, storage here, and I think I can show. Yeah, that's the network here. I will tell you later why there is no network here. So, this is a classical three-tier representation of your application environment. So, what do you see from those graphs? You need to understand how to read them. But on the left side, you see request versus error in time. So, you see requests coming in, you see some error. On the database side, you see the same requests or responses, I'm now looking at, and a bunch of errors, right? And on storage, if I move it up, you see in the beginning some errors, while there were responses, and now here. So, This is a typical drawing you do for a classical multi-tier environment. Where, if you look in time, so there are two ways for us to determine in multi-tier applications if some tiers are causing problems for other tiers. That's either time-based, this is the time-based way, and there is another option that is if you look at user IDs and follow them along your tiers, right? Time-based is here, so take a look over here. At the time, you see HTTP errors popping up. They are not saying which errors they are right now, right? But those are HTTP status code errors. They appear, and that's appearing in the same period when my database is causing a bunch of errors. Typically, in multi-tier applications, the web front end is a representation of things which happens down, the good or the bad. So those errors are likely to be the cause of the fact that I see errors over here. And in here, I need to go and drill down further to prove. But I can assure you that those errors are being caused by those errors, which are the typical type of errors here. You can go into that later on. But by looking from a time-based point of view, you can spot on, identify my problems in my database here are causing errors at my web tier, users are experiencing errors. So the errors on HTTP here are checkout errors, and on my database are, in this case, too many connections. So there's one server which is overloaded by the amount of connections. It will not accept more connections. And at the front end, it's not able to, let's say, process your URL, right? We can also tell that at the same time there was nothing wrong with your storage, right? Look at the same time here. This is all clean. Not a problem at all. And on the right side we have some more details, which tells you how not looking at request versus errors, but more looking from a processing point of view. So at the top, you see your web here, how the processing time is adding up at that period. This is the same period as we see there here, right? And you see also some other things which we monitor is the zero windows in, zero windows out. Why do we do that? To see if the server is causing an error. Here, I know for sure that HTTP is having a problem. It's not related to the server, but it's related to some process which is taking a long time. And that was not due to the server on the web here, but due to the fact that the database was having serious issue. On the other side, while the processing time is increasing over here, my database processing time is fine, right? But there's nothing wrong in my database side from a processing point of view, but there is something wrong on this side, yeah? So, if you want to see, more, tell me what error is the top. You see? Responses by error, too many connections. 3,500 errors. I see those are, you're looking at the outliers. So those errors, those all red things you saw over here, are caused by too many connections over there. And I can further drill down by saying, okay, which client is being affected? Here you see 3.6k errors, too many error connections caused by a client 10.10.1.106. I bet you that that's my HTTP server, right? Yeah. I will finish up. Yeah. Cool. We can continue with the story. The last thing I wanted to tell you is that. So this is the classical three-tier approach by being able to identify where is my real problem. And another thing, which what you see over here, is that for the network side, there was no data. And I was looking at network errors. Serious network errors are identified by what we call retransmission timeouts. Retransmission timeout means I send a packet, I don't get an acknowledge, wait, send it again, don't get an acknowledge again. And that's happening three times before I flag it as a request timeout. That means serious amount of milliseconds delay, which is normally causing applications to slow down, because the side effect of this is that the TCP stack will downsize your window size, and I don't have to explain you that downsizing your window size is not a good thing from an application point of view. That's it, what I wanted to cover, except this one. That's my last slide, so you will get the presentation, so you can see all the other things over there, very interesting screenshots and stories around. I would say, if you think, yeah, I want to see what is happening, what are the possibilities of actual giving me insight in application behavior and get back the control, go to this website, /demo, Extrahop is VM running in the cloud as a demo. There are some guided tools, so you can go through some use cases over there, or you can play with yourself. If you have opportunities, don't do that. Right? Thank you all. Thank you.
Sure, but are still some questions for Rob today?
How do you handle encrypted traffic?
Okay. Always those questions. So encryption is, as far as it is SSL, HTTPS, it's not a problem. So what we can do, we have a piece of hardware addition on a KVM chipset running for handling this SSL uploading. So we can, when we get SSL traffic in, we need to have the private key stored on our box. And based on the private key, we can decrypt traffic and then we can take a look in the traffic. For the rest, we do not do anything. It's just that we can see, okay, it's HTTPS or it's FTP or whatever encrypted thing. Being able to peel off, let's say, the encryption part. And having said, that does not work for PFS environments, right? then you need to be a full process, right? Other questions?
Any special tools for wireless devices? We can do something with this, or we need to get the data onto some kind of wire?
No, wireless works as well, as long as we see that transaction, right? So imagine that you're at a site or a remote location where you have a lot of wireless LAN. Once we get in wireless LAN, so the controller hands off to the physical network, connects to the router, the switch, or whatever, and if that switch router sends off the data to us, then we can also give you insight into that bank. That's actually a very nice use case. Everybody, more and more people are moving towards wireless, but not everybody makes a good design. So too less capacity on APs or too less capacity on the capabilities of the APs. I've had once a customer where we were measuring also that wireless behavior, and we saw spikes in round trip time spiking up as a result of the fact that the density was not good, the connection was not good, there was a lot of interference, and as a result for the customer, the client, the performance was going down. So we can do that as long as that traffic is sent to us. So that's what I was saying. We call it wire data, but it's more the data in your infrastructure, wired or wireless.
Can we connect to the remote spine?
Yeah, so we support the physical one, the port mirror link. We support R-span, laser-span, ER-span, and also those technologies from let's say, the virtualized environment. So from an hypervisor, you can set up ER-span, R-span, two or so. So that's all covered. Other questions? Christoph? No?
Thanks, Rolf. Then we suggest we have a 10-minute break.